I gotta make sure I'm in the shot now. I've been leaning back, sculpting while I was waiting.
Well, that's hardly a miniature you've got there.
Yeah.
Look at that.
This is a Myth Boss. I'm trying to bake it. I've been baking him in a couple stages. Here's the little guy I've been working on.
Huh. Yeah.
I prefer doing them smaller. It is fun to do these, but it just takes a lot of work. There's just so much to do.
Now, do they 3D scan that thing?
No. Maybe. Okay. Maybe. They might. Traditionally, no. Over in China, I think. It's kind of hard to tell. Mm-hmm. They still seem to hide a lot of little secrets and stuff, so I'm not entirely sure.
Yeah.
So, I know some places do, but some places have other methods still, apparently. But, yeah. So, what are your questions? Do you have any questions or you want to talk about? Yeah, anything you want to show off? Or?
No, I don't have anything to show off. Obviously, right. just got my stands done. And I was thinking about probably starting to sculpt something larger than...
Mm-hmm.
30 millimeter miniature. Is, I mean, I've done a little sculpting in the past, but you know, kind of cartoon character stuff. More something that you might see kind of like a Hallmark kind of a thing, mm-hmm. you know. But nothing quite as, you know, as figural. You know, where I had to worry about proportions and things like that so much.
Yeah. That's cool. Well, I had to strap two of my bases together to hold this guy. This was one of my first stands.
I can tell. It's nice and brown.
Yep. I had to make... my first big commission jobs were 54 millimeter figures, so I had larger ones. But what were you going to say?
Well, I had a lot of material, so I made about six small ones and a couple of larger ones.
Cool.
So that worked out pretty well. Now you said you've baked off this guy once already?
Yeah. Let's see. Yeah, this will be the second time after I finish with this hair stuff. So I did, what did I do? I did everything except for all this hair. I actually did do this part, but all this, his back and the hair on top wasn't done yet. So all that was done, I guess this would be the third bake. Anyways, I did the whole body except for that and except for the, hand, this hand. Is that right? No, I did it. There we go. I did basically all of that except for the hair and back. Then I did the hands and arm, and now I'm doing that. So, and I'm using, actually, because he's so large, I'm able to use the same technique where I press green stuff down, and then I put clay over it. So you probably can't see, but there's a little bit sticking out of the green. But it actually works very well. You can do that on smaller stuff, but you just have to be careful it doesn't bulk up too fast.
Yeah.
So what are you thinking about sculpting next or first?
Yeah, that's a good question.
It always helps me to have an assignment.
Yeah, that's for sure. There were a couple of fairly larger things. I have a kind of a broken out, it's an hourglass that I was going to sculpt something around that.
Oh, that's cool.
You know, so I was going to maybe kind of do that to warm myself up, because I think if I go right to a 30 millimeter miniature, I might just give up and and run. But no, I've painted miniatures in the past a lot. Yeah.
Oop, I think you're breaking up.
So
there you are.
I've done a little bit. I mean, obviously nothing like this, but I've poked around.
Cool. So yeah, so you are into miniatures and stuff.
Yeah, I've been in the hobby for a while. I haven't painted miniatures for a long time because it became such a time sink that I like the result, but I never played as much as I painted, and it's just kind of like, I'd rather be employed.
I hear ya.
Yeah.
I'm actually trying to do more painting myself. But.
Oh, yeah? You painting your own stuff?
Have I ever painted my own stuff? I don't know if I've ever painted. I did paint some Merc's miniatures a long time ago, but it was mostly just for a demo. I planned on doing them myself, but now that I think about it, I'm not sure I've actually ever painted any of my own miniatures. Maybe I should have some time. I don't know. I stare at them so long, but when I get down to paint, I'm like excited to paint other people's stuff.
I can imagine.
I've only recently gotten back into it, though.
Well, the only thing that's really given me the urge to really, really, really want to paint is that Dreadfleet game with the pirate ships. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you probably have seen that somewhere.
Yeah. Older one, right? It came out a couple years ago?
Yeah. That stuff is just so freaking amazing.
Yeah, they're very, very detailed. I had a couple buddies that had that.
I picked it up probably a year and a half ago at about $60 bucks. So.
Oh, wow. That's a good deal.
Yep.
That seems to be a trend with their new board games these days. Because they always do like the limited, but they never quite seem to sell out of them.
Well, there was I don't know if you had heard, but it seemed like I had read some stuff that there was a recall of whatever was left of those from their Games Workshop stores, and they ended up, I mean, here's the rumor, is they ended up destroying the ones they had recalled, but obviously if you weren't a Games Workshop store, you kept your stock, and so I don't know. I don't know if there's any merit to it at all.
That'd be pretty interesting. Maybe they're trying to get people to say, hey, I better grab this while I can.
Keep it limited and all that, but they're opening up and doing their own board games again.
Yeah.
Which is probably a good move.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely seems what's hot right now.
Indeed. Well, it's kind of funny to be involved in this today, and then I had gotten a 3D printer over Christmas. Just finally got that up and running, and it's cranking away downstairs right now.
Yeah. Oh, you did? That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
No, it's okay. No, it's just a junior version. You know, I'm just kind of seeing what it can do. I don't think it can do anything major, but it'll be fun to play with.
How do I... somebody else is trying to get on. I'm trying to figure out. Oh, this is funny. I'm coming on the video. Somebody found the Hangout and wants to join.
Oh, a random?
I guess. I don't know how to invite him, though, because I don't have his email. I have to have an email.
Yeah.
Anyways. It's for you guys anyways, so. It's just funny that I didn't realize somebody could find it. But it was hidden.
Well,
but I guess if they're subscribed to my channel, they must get a message. I'm still apparently figuring this thing out. I thought I had it all figured out, and then
you're not the only
happening.
One.
So anyways, Anton, if you're hearing this, I would invite you, but I'm not sure how. Anyways. Yeah, so that's cool. That I like the idea of your project to do something with the hourglass. That's cool.
Well, you know, it's something I don't really have to worry about muscles and proportions so much. I can just kind of work on technique for a little while.
Mm-hmm. That's a lot of this stuff is learning how to handle the material.
Right.
Because, yeah, it does take some, it does take a bit of time to get used to.
Well, I've got some green stuff sitting around, and I've got a brick of the gray, the Sculpey firm.
Mm-hmm.
Still sitting around. I'm assuming it's still good. It's been packed up for a while.
You might have to condition it some, but it should still be fine.
So, I mean, I've got some... It's not like I have to invest a lot in going out and buying clay right now. So that's mm-hmm. kind of cool.
Yeah.
So you're not breaking any... You're not breaking any clauses in your contract by showing this miniature right now, are you?
No.
Okay. All right.
It's all right. Nobody watches this. No, actually, one of my bosses does tend to watch the videos, so I guess I'll find out. No, he doesn't care usually. So. I think I've had this on another video before, too, so... Plus, it's pretty blurry, although it does show up pretty well.
It's all right.
I could wait. I could wait to post this officially.
Well, I'll post a bunch of screenshots and see what happens.
Yeah.
I'm kidding. I won't do that.
I'm not worried. So, yep. I'm pretty excited how this guy's turning out, though.
That's pretty massive. I didn't get in on any of the myth stuff, but I looked at a bunch of it. It's quite a pile.
Yeah, it is. A lot of miniatures for me and other sculptors, and it's been fun to do a lot of fantasy. I've been basically stuck on sci-fi for years back. Working on Mercs, and then when I had some of my own lines. They tended to be sci-fi as well, and but I started in fantasy, and I don't know. I think I am more of a sci-fi guy, but there is definitely a place in my soul for fantasy.
Well, so sure.
It's nice to just sometimes work on the more organic stuff.
Yeah, I was thinking that the sci-fi stuff, that was maybe one thing I was kind of wondering about, looking at some Forge World... sculpts, casts recently. They have some really, you know, straight, sharp, rigid kind of, I don't know what you'd call them. They're not organic forms. They're like tech, you know, it's tech stuff.
Are they still just, is it just a bit, you mean the terrain, or do they actually have figures?
No, figures. They're doing some... Still doing. Forge World is doing some resin stuff.
Oh, Forge World! My brain said whatever the dungeon tile thing is.
Oh yeah.
Dwarven Forge. Dwarven Forge. That's what my brain heard. Yeah, Forge World. Yeah. Oof.
That's so good stuff. Well, and for what I gather is they're doing their stuff, you know, in the computer. But so
they have a lot of traditional stuff still.
Do they?
I mean, some of that depends on what you're talking about. I'm sure there is some, but a lot of the individual characters are traditional still.
So when you're doing something that has to be sort of that rigid and that symmetrical and that sharp, I mean, is that, I mean, just a matter of just working it until it looks right? Or?
Yeah, I really don't prefer doing that sort of stuff. And when I would prefer to use a computer, and I don't know. It's interesting. When, like, if you got a guy in armor, I feel like I can get away with it more. You know, getting away with stuff not being 100% exact and symmetrical because they're moving and they're dynamic. But when you have something that's more like a robot, especially if it's not a humanoid robot, it seems like it's a lot more noticeable when stuff is off. But just some people are better than others, and you know it helps use techniques where you're grinding away and filing rather than just doing hand sculpting, because it's very easy to have inconsistent areas and stuff. So, but that's so that's what I tend to do if I can. I do as much filing because it tends to be easier to keep stuff nice and clean.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just thinking about looking at that stuff because I mean, obviously, before the computer, I mean, the 3D sculpting is, as far as miniatures are concerned, isn't that new. They had to do it some way.
Yep.
In the past.
There's a, what's his name? Jeff Wilhelm. He is a great mech sculptor. If you ever saw any of the Dark Age, Mech Warrior Dark Age miniatures, the old Clicks line.
Oh, from WizKids?
Yes.
Okay.
He did, I don't know if he did all of them, he did a ton of them, and they were all by hand.
Oh, wow.
He, plastic card, green stuff mixed with, you know, all basically anything he could, but lots of filing, lots of assembling, and he is just, and that's how good he is. You basically can't tell that it was kitbashed together and sculpted. So,
well,
pretty impressive.
Yeah, it is, for sure. And, well, with their material that they use, if there were any flaws, that they'd be covered up because, you know, they're not cast perfectly and they warp a little bit, so.
The paint, fills in some. Yeah.
For sure. But, yeah, I'm not going to take anything away from the guy. That's pretty amazing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I used to be able to, I don't know if he still has them up, but used to be able to find pictures of them in process, and there's so many different colors because he would use all these different plastics and putties and stuff and other materials to make the different elements. It's pretty cool.
It is cool.
So what kind of tutorials are you looking for next?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know. That posing and procedures, like there was one where you had modeled a figure, I think it was Sci-Fi Hacker, some of those videos.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that was my first ones before I was even really doing a channel.
Yeah, and, you know, the arms weren't developed yet, and then just, at some point you had, after doing some puttying and modeling stuff, you had kind of put the arms into a kind of a crossed arm type of a pose.
Okay, yeah.
I don't know. Just procedural stuff. You know, when's the right time to do this and maybe the right time to do that. And obviously, I'm sure I'll come across some of that stuff when I get around to it.
Yeah.
But, I don't know. Something like that or like a three-point pose, you know, like the Iron Man landing kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. There's lots of interesting considerations with stuff like that about how you have to cut it and what you have to plan to do. It's a good idea. I hope to get on, answer some of those questions. I want to do more, maybe not complete sculpts, but like longer things where I'm, following the process along. And I can kind of address a lot of those things more, so. But yeah, it's funny you bring that up. There's actually, I just was just thinking about how much I've kind of changed my technique and stuff, because that was still when I was doing everything in Procreate.
Uh-huh.
And so with putty and the way I tended to sculpt with it, it was very halting and not mechanical, but I guess procedural, like you said, would be the right word, where I had to, I had to do this part, and then I would do this part, and and I like to let things set up a lot more back then, which you don't necessarily have to do with putty, but for some reason, just I always seem to wreck what I was sculpting when it wasn't cured. It may, I don't know, it's weird because now that I do FEMO, I almost never touch something that is still wet. I just don't. It's weird. But to this day, if I start sculpting with putty, I will invariably plant my finger in it. It's weird. I don't know what it is.
You've got a psychological block.
It is, yeah. So it's all I can figure is that my brain's saying, well, it's putty, so it's going to cure, or it is cured, so it's okay to touch. And even though I know for a fact I'm working on something that isn't done yet, you know, even here with all this that's cured and stuff, I know this is wet, so I just don't touch it. It's not a big deal. And this is a big figure.
That's great. Like I said, I have a bunch of the Sculpey Firm stuff that I wasn't going to run out and grab FEMO yet or anything. I was just going to use that.
It's actually, especially if it's fresh, fairly fresh, and that's where the conditioning might need to come in, it actually is feels pretty similar to me. It might be a little firmer, and that might be where, like, you might decide you like it more or don't like it as much. I actually prefer my clay kind of soft.
Okay.
But I've got a buddy who he does not at all. He prefers it to be super stiff, and just as long as it works, as long as you get results with it. I've worked with both kinds and just make it to be a little easier to push around.
Well, I remember doing some patching and stuff with green stuff and sitting there wondering, how in the hell do you guys sculpt with this? It's so sticky and kind of...
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. That was like what was used for so many years exclusively. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I was happy to move on from it. Although, it's funny because now when I do use it a lot still, but never for large things, just like little bits, and I don't mind it for that, but...
Yeah.
Just trying to make sure nobody else is trying to get in every now and then.
Yeah.
I think we're good. I think it's just us tonight.
Well, it'd be nice to be able to get that other person in.
Yeah, usually. He's been on every single month, so. But I know he's got a busy schedule, so sometimes he ends up he can't make it, so. Play any games these days?
Ooh, yeah. I was, what was I just looking at recently? I was looking at some Shadows of Brimstone stuff. I pretty much have that book sitting on my side table here all the time because that's kind of a lifestyle game, you know. You got to study that one. There's a lot going on there.
Well, if you kickstarted it, you've got a lot coming still, too.
I did, and yes, there's a pile coming.
Yeah.
But as far as really played, mostly, you know, my girlfriend, she's not into the heavy nerdy board games like I am, but but she likes Lords of Waterdeep, so.
I've actually never played it. It looks super fun, though.
It is, and it's really, I mean, within like a turn or so, everybody's like, okay, I pretty much know what I'm doing. Taught it to her.
There's somebody. Is this Anton? Andrew. It's Andrew.
Yep.
Welcome.
Thanks.
I'm glad you made it.
Thank you.
So, real quick, how were you able to get in? Did it just pop up with the in the Messenger program, or did the second link I send you work?
Yeah, I'm actually on my phone right now.
Okay. So just it probably sent it to you through Hangouts then, it sounds like. That's how I get it on, because I actually have my computer running the stream and then my phone recording from a separate account, because I don't have a good webcam otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
So. Cool. I'm just showing off this Myth Boss I'm sculpting right now.
Cool.
He's a handful.
Literally.
So, how many of those sculpt stands do you have taped together?
I have two. So, yeah, this is one of the standard size ones that I showed in the video. And this is one of my first sculpt stands I ever made, because the first professional ones that I figures I did were these large 54 millimeter figures, so I needed something wider. But this guy's even wider than both of those, any of that, so I just taped two together instead of making something new. And the tape actually withstands baking, which is nice. I was a little worried at first, but I thought it might melt off. I knew it would be okay even if it did, but yeah, so it holds up.
That one measure?
What'd you say?
How tall does that one measure?
Let's see. Where's my ruler? Here it is. I want to say 70-something. Oops. Oh, he's probably 85 to the top of the hair.
Okay. Cool. So
he's pretty big. He's got a giant mace war staff or something, but that's at work. So, this will probably be going up on the updates next week. Everybody can see it in all its glory. So, yeah. So, you have any questions, Andrew? Just coming here to hang out?
Yeah, just wanted to see what you were up to. And,
cool.
I don't know if you saw my blog, but I just finished my first sculpt.
Cool.
So,
let me see if I can find it real quick.
Yeah, check
it out. Is it tied to your Google Plus? If I go there, can I find it? Yep, there it is. All right. That was a bigger picture. Cool. So what are you using?
I've been following your techniques pretty closely. So I started with a wire armature with Nidotite, and then I detailed it out with Sculpey.
Okay, cool. I wasn't sure. Oh, regular Sculpey.
It's a Super Sculpey.
Oh, it is Super Sculpey? Okay, I wasn't sure. It looks kind of white on my screen, so I didn't know if it was...
Yeah,
regular.
Well, I didn't have any photos of it until after I already primed it.
Mm. Oh, okay. That makes sense.
It's actually a version with primer. I ran into some trouble baking it,
mm-hmm.
and the top half of it got overcooked.
I've been hearing that a lot from people, not specifically, on my channel or anything, but just out and about, people using Super Sculpey. It does tend to get, like, hot spots or something. If you like Sculpey and you want to pick up, you might try picking up a block of their Sculpey 3. It okay. seems to be a little more, and it comes a bunch of different colors. It's the same size as a block of Fimo, and mm-hmm. it seems to be more supple. Okay. Which is the one thing I really like about the Fimo. It's never cracked on me or anything. It's very hard and you can cut it and stuff, but it also, I don't know, it just tends to have a little give to it still. It doesn't become brittle.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know if I've said this, but yep. I actually converted, I made, I think, 5 different miniatures with the same original sculpt. I just kept cutting it up, adding putty to fix gaps and stuff, but it had the same base Fimo form through five mold makings in a vulcanizer. And it, I could probably make another one if I want to. No, but this is really good, man. I'm you seem to have done a really good job of keeping the not getting it too bulky and stuff.
Thanks.
Which is when I was teaching classes at Gen Con, it was the biggest thing I noticed. People's trouble, a lot of the people were, some of the people, it was the very first time, and it is a challenge to deal with both of these materials for your first time. So, yeah, I think the next thing you'll just be developing then is working on the lighter touch, just to, you know, get a little smoother where you want it and things right. like that. But yeah, this is your first miniature though. That's great.
Yeah, I'm definitely looking forward to doing more.
Cool. And look, you've painted your own.
Yeah.
I'm going to cast this real fast so people can see it. Let me see. Let's go here. Let's screen share this. Share. And now people will be able to see it. So, yeah. But you can go check out Andrew's blog, see what he's doing. And this is what I wanted to show and say is, because we were talking about this earlier, and I realized that I haven't ever completely finished painting any of my own miniatures. I don't think ever.
Oh.
I've started to, but look, your first miniature and you've already painted it.
That's pretty cool. What's the character?
It looks like you go and tell Andrew.
She's called White Rabbit. She's a Spider-Man villain. My goal is to do primarily Marvel characters.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that'd be a fun one to start off with.
That's a heck of a good first miniature.
Yeah. I need to work on this. Maybe I'll get to do it next month. I want to create some sort of board or something where everybody can start sharing their sculpts, show off what they're doing, and
yeah, that'd be cool.
I think that'd be neat. Maybe I do a contest every now and then or something.
Yeah, you know, I've done a lot of conversions before. Mm-hmm. So I like how I got interested in the sculpting part of it. Mm-hmm. So, I'll be posting to my blog. I don't really have a schedule for it, but I'll, as I do more work in painting, sculpting, whatever.
It'll be there. Cool. Got to turn a little more off here.
So is there any, are there any differences when you're working at that scale as opposed to doing like 30mm? I mean, obviously there are, but
right. Go ahead.
What kind of differences are there?
So for me, the biggest thing is that you can't. It's harder to use a lot of the little. I guess I'll call them cheats, little tricks, because the areas are so large, you have to be a lot more deliberate with the smoothing, because it's easier to tell when something hasn't been refined enough. You also have to be, like I mentioned earlier, he'll be going his third bake tonight. So I did basically everything except for these forearms and then the hair and his back, I did in one go. And then baked it. Then I did these forearms and the hand, and then I did some of the hair, baked it again, and now I'm going to basically finish it off, and then he'll be done baking. I'll do everything else with, like, putty. I might do this hand, actually, in clay still, because it's so large. But you don't have to. You could do this all in one bake, but he's very tall, and I was getting a little nervous that I was going to screw something up. Because when they get taller like this, they tend to wiggle a little more, even though he's pretty stable. And you want to put your finger somewhere to help just keep it steady. So that's the biggest thing, is just having to, and then having to put in more detail, because it just looks plain if you don't. So you have to watch out for stuff like that. And it just takes time. I mean, if you think about it, like, this leg is as much putty as I would use, or clay I would use for an entire regular, you know, 35 millimeter miniature, or close to it. You know, and he's got two legs, two arms, and this body. I mean, he's probably like a block of, at least, no, he's got probably a couple blocks of FEMO, actually, now that I think about it. Yeah, I actually blew through a couple. So, and normally, you know, I get several miniatures out of that, so. And for me, at least with what I'm working with, I prefer my clay to be softer, so. And when you're working with such large chunks, you have to work a little harder to keep it warm when you're first applying it, so you can smooth it and blend it better. But in some ways, it's kind of nice, because you can get it on there, you can leave it for a minute, and this clay that you leave gets a little cooler, less malleable, and it tends to support the figure a little better. And then you can go on with other parts that you want to be softer without, you know, squishing around everything underneath. Tell you bake it, then it's fine. But
does that have more bulk of green stuff underneath it?
Yeah, I did a lot of the base level. You know, I did take a picture, and I'm gonna put this up on Twitter soon to show it. But I made him with thicker wire to begin with. So I normally use 24 gauge steel, and this is 22 gauge steel. But the entire armature is two wires twisted together. So through the legs, arms, everything. And once that was done, I bulked him up with green stuff and a mix of Aves, because I have a ton of Aves, and in Aves also sets up faster. So I bulked him up, you know, around the wire, kind of like I do with the small ones. But then I went ahead and just, you know, like, especially in here, you know, he's got this large torso form, so I just built these larger shapes to kind of fill the space a bit, or give more of, like, platforms for the clay to go on. So I wouldn't have to just use tons and tons and tons of clay, which wouldn't be bad, actually, to use more clay than putty, because clay is actually cheaper than putty, but it's obviously, I would have had to bake it, and I didn't want to bake it that many times. You let that all set up, and then I would kind of move to what the traditional style would be, where I lay down the skin of green stuff, and then the skin of the first layer of FEMO, and then go from there. That's pretty normal. So,
how many times can you bake a figure? Is there a point where it, like?
Well, like I was saying, for the FEMO, I am not entirely sure that there is a point. I'm sure there is a point, but at least at the temperatures that it gets baked at and that it gets vulcanized at, I've done it a lot, and it still holds up. And I can't say this is the same for Sculpey or anything else. In my experience, I wouldn't say Sculpey could last a lot, because it does tend to get brittle just at its normal cooking temperature. But maybe you weren't here when I said it. I did actually convert. I used the same sculpt, the same base sculpt, five times to me, because he was part of a squad, and so I made him. Sent it off to the mold maker, got the sculpt back, cut them up, reposed it, patched things up, sent it off again, and I ended up, so that means I cooked it, so that means I baked it once, originally, and then I molded it four times. And I'm pretty sure it got, it actually got baked twice, because it's actually not a bad idea to bake your sculpts twice with the FEMO, because it tends to temper it, make it a little stronger. Because when it gets hot again the first time, it can get a little soft still. But after that second bake, it tends to set up and kind of retain its hardness a little more. But so I don't know but I've done it four times, and I've never four or five times technically, and I've never come close to baking it that many times again. I did cook this guy for a short amount of time, because I knew I'd be baking him any time, so I actually have only done it for half. I usually cook him for an hour, but I've only cooked him half an hour each time, just in case. But you know, it seems just as hard as it was if I did it for an hour. So, and then I'll probably, when I do the final bake, I'll just throw it in for an hour just to kind of make sure everything's nice and set.
But people more experienced than me have told me to back off the temperature on Sculpey.
Yeah, I've tend to hear that. I actually turn my FEMO temperature up from what they recommend.
Oh.
But you do have to be careful because I don't know the exact temperature. I think it says in the package it can release, apparently it can release toxic fumes if you get too high. So I wouldn't go too much higher. But I think the key with it is more just the length of time even than the height of the heat. Because it just gives it that much more time to bake through. And if I haven't said it on another video, I think I have, but I also, when I'm baking it, I put the sculpt in when the oven's preheating and run the time for that. So even though it's in there for an hour, you know, it's probably takes at least 10 minutes for it to get to temperature, so full temperature anyway. So, and that just helps it, you know, heat a little more evenly. Which might also be some of the problem with Sculpey. Oops. Some of the outer parts might be getting scorched.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I don't know.
You using a toaster oven or just a regular oven?
I've been using my regular oven because I never got a fancy toaster oven or some other heater thing. So, but it would be the same. It would be the same principle.
Is it Andrew? I'm sorry. Are you using a toaster oven?
Yeah, I use the toaster oven.
Okay. It's probably too close to the coils then.
Oh, it could be.
I think so, because it was noticeably cooking from the top down.
Mm.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I don't know then. I know in the past when I've cooked larger stuff, with Sculpey in a conventional oven, you know, and it would get kind of close to the coils, and yeah, it would definitely get it would get scorched.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I fortunately I caught it before any real damage happened, so lowered the temperature.
Mm-hmm.
For the remainder of the cooking time, and that seems to have worked fine. Had a little bit of repair work to do on some of the areas that really got charred, but I don't know. I think it came out all right.
Yeah. Well, at least you didn't lose the whole thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's always nerve-wracking.
Hey, Tom.
Hey, you made it.
Yeah.
So it was Rich, Andrew, and I actually don't know your... Is that your last name? Lane?
It's Lane, yeah.
You did tell me that before. I forgot.
How's everybody doing?
Hello.
Hello.
You got anything cool to show off, Rich?
Yeah. I finally completed that miniature and actually cast it and all that.
Oh, sweet.
I'll put a link.
Did you send it off, or you have your own kit, don't you, Resin?
Yeah, I just cast it myself. Yeah. I'll post a link.
Cool. I think I need to quit messing with this hair. I don't know.
Sorry, just getting get the link. Into the chat.
Alright. There we go. Okay. This one is screen share. There we go. have to do it on this one. Okay. It's weird.
What kind of lighting do you use when you're working?
My favorite thing, I'm trying to remember what it's called. It's one of these, let me see if I can get it in the shot. Oh, let me switch here. Stop sharing. Go back to this. There we go. It's one of these big lights with the magnifier in it.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
So, it's just those big fluorescents with the circular fluorescent. Mm-hmm. I like it because I actually never use a magnifying glass. A lot of people think I do, but I don't. But I like how it creates a ring of light around the piece instead of a spotlight on it.
Oh, yeah.
It seems to kill shadows a lot better. Oh. And makes it easier to not be fooled. Your eye won't be fooled because you've got kind of even light all around it.
Yeah.
Especially good for faces.
That makes sense. Yeah, so, the lighting in my workspace sucks, so I've been using a headlamp.
Oh, yeah, that works too.
Yeah.
All right, so here's Rich's dwarf guy, right?
Yeah. There's so, you can see the first picture is completely baked and removed from the base, and then the next pictures are after he's been cut up.
So let's see, yeah. So I can't remember. We were talking about how to cut it up, and you thought it was because you didn't want the mold line, right? That's why you decided to do him at the waist, because you don't want the mold line over the face.
Right.
So good call.
So those are just more pictures of him cut. So then this is was me put together, him put together, the plastic version.
Mm-hmm.
So all the pieces were cast and then reassembled. I had to use a little Procreate because I didn't completely fill the mold properly. So
they had to do some patching.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's cool. You know, it was my first time doing it, so.
Yeah, it's trickier than it looks. It's not super hard, but it's also is a little tricky to mold that stuff. Cool. It's fun. It's crazy. You can see how much more of the details you can see, like versus this.
Yeah.
Tan stuff.
I noticed that right away, and I was going to bring that up at our meeting.
Well, and also we've got these gigantic pictures too, so.
Yeah.
Oops.
Yeah. It looks much better in hand.
The
photos.
Oh, that'd be a fun thing. I need to show off. My dad's a photographer, and he took this super crazy huge macro picture of a figure I did and blew it up to like 19x13 or something, and it looks terrible. The picture is great, but the miniature doesn't look nearly as good. So, yeah. Cool, man. Yeah, that totally saved you on the mold line there on the face because it would have been right down the middle of his nose, for sure. So what's next? What are you gonna work on next?
I'm just finishing up other in progress minis, and I'm actually one of the things I wanted to ask you was, have you ever done any like bigger sculpts besides miniatures?
I have done technically two. One was I think he ended up being a foot tall. Mm-hmm. I can't remember if the figure itself was actually a foot tall or if it ended up being a foot tall. It was for an art show right after I was in college, and I wanted to do something sculptural, so it was like this knight on this cliff or something. So, yeah, two or three larger, and I don't know. I don't know. I always wanted to try action figures and stuff like that, but I never did. And like you see here, I mean, this guy is 85 millimeters tall, we just measured, but this is technically a miniature. I mean, it's huge, so I mean, is it? Is it not? I mean, it's supposed to go with 35 millimeter miniatures, so. How big is he in inches? What would that be? I can't do the math in my head right now. Oh, yeah. He's like 3.5 inches ish. But, yeah, so no, except for the case of, you know, these larger guys every now and then, almost everything I do is miniature. Okay. So, but I was saying it earlier, is a big difference is just, you know, it just takes a lot more material, and it can be harder to work with, too, especially if you don't want your material, if you want material to be softer, mm-hmm. you have to warm it up more, because there's, you know, there's more material to warm up, and things like that, and you just have to pick out a lot more detail on the figures, typically, unless it's a, you know, supposed to be more of a simple cartoony looking thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But are you thinking about doing something bigger?
Yeah. I got this Street Fighter V game.
Oh.
And it was the collector's edition, and it came with this Ryu statue.
Mm-hmm.
Which looked really cool, and I was like, I want to sculpt something like this.
Yeah. So. Well, I have a friend who a fellow sculptor. I'm gonna try and get on here for an interview, and he's doing miniatures now, but he actually came from the action figure and still does action figures background. So if I can get him on here for an interview, I'll definitely be asking him about that sort of stuff and kind of considerations. And although you might have to learn a new material if you want to do his techniques, because he actually sculpts pretty much all in wax.
Yeah.
So,
I've been reading this book. I'll show you in a second. This is the Ryu statue that I that inspired me. But I've been reading this book, which is mostly about toys and larger things. And like about half the people or more all do their stuff in wax.
Yeah. I'm not saying it's better or worse, but I do think it seems like it's... I'm sure it is a good material for that, but it also kind of seems like... I wonder if it's kind of like green stuff, where everybody just use green stuff because that's what you used, mm-hmm. even though you totally could use other stuff, but it's just what... I mean, to some degree, it is what you need to use because... mold makers didn't have low temp rubbers and stuff, so they needed something that could withstand a lot of heat and pressure, a lot more heat and pressure than they can we can deal with nowadays. But you know, all in what works. So I mean, a lot of the Sideshow Collectible and those kind of guys, they're all doing it in Super Sculpey or Sculpey Firm.
Yeah, that's what I'm planning to use, mainly because that's what I have available right
yeah.
now.
Yeah, I think you'll do fine with that. Then, yeah. You can carry over what you've been practicing already. So. It's just, and I think you will definitely want to keep that, the whatever this is called, the terpenoid or mineral spirits or whatever it is. I tend to use that stuff a lot more on these big figures. It's much more helpful, because especially when you're trying to get stuff done fast, because you can just splat on stuff, the basic forms and muscles, and then it's nice to do a little coat. Although you do kind of you do want to step away from it and give it a chance to evaporate some, because it like we talked about before, it will break down the surface
right
a lot, and you can end up making some nasty looking squishes and stuff. But did you find that book you were talking about?
Yeah, I just put the link in the...
Cool. Oh, there it is. I gotcha. Right, let's pop that one. Where's the other thing? And this one.
Funny, I was just looking at that one not too long ago.
Yeah, it's a really good book.
Yeah, it looks, a peek inside of it, looks like it's got some great stuff in there.
Yeah. It's not so much helpful for, like, miniatures, but
yeah,
they're, everything else, it's fantastic.
Yeah, because there are a lot more considerations when it comes to the armatures you build and stuff, depending on how big the figure is.
Right.
I may have to check that one out sometime.
So, Tom, are you the one that has to decide how this thing gets broken apart for the mold?
Yeah. Well, okay. I do, because I know. Yeah, sometimes I'll consult with the mold maker, but I've done this long enough that I tend to know what needs to be done. And
but are the mold makers normally, are they counting on you for that, or is that something they would normally do?
If I didn't do it, they would just do it because they're good enough, and they know what they're doing. So, but I like to do it myself when I can, just because then I know I can sculpt certain details, certain places. Mm-hmm. I can make sure that, you know, like I cut in this muscle if I wanted. I mean, not that they do look for that. Like, they wouldn't just cut this guy's arm right here, you know.
Yeah.
If they didn't have to, they would look for a seam like that or a gauntlet or something. But, yeah, I usually just end up doing it myself. So this guy will actually, I need to remember to record this. I was going to do a kind of a follow-up parting video that shows us some other tools to use when you have something big and massive like this. Because I did do some of the pre-scoring like I talked about, but uh-huh. even with that, because this guy's armature is thicker wire and it's double spun wire, two wires spun together, it's very hard. And you know, there's just so much more material. It's very hard to do that wiggle and bend off. It's too strong. Uh-huh. So I'll end up using a special saw and a couple other things. So.
Cool.
So yeah, but it's still good and very helpful to plan for that sort of thing ahead of time. That's a cool statue. Stop sharing. Yeah. So I am excited to get back to little stuff again, though. This just takes so long.
A lot of ground to cover.
Yep. I should just stop with the hair, too, because I think I'm kind of to the point where I just need to bake it, and then I need to, like, add on little bits with putty if I really have to, just to finish it off. So.
When I was looking at areas, like, where the loincloth kind of thing is, mm-hmm. where it's kind of, you've got kind of it would be an undercut kind of a thing.
Yeah.
Are you going to build that up?
I can't see it, maybe. I am going to build up a little more. Like, I don't know if you can see that on this part.
Yeah, I can now.
There's green. I actually already did fill it in with green stuff. But I don't know if you can see under here. That is totally void right now. So, but I couldn't quite get to it. And usually I just wait till I pop them off the base, because then you just turn them upside down, pack it in. But yeah, definitely you have to fill that stuff in. I can actually, because this will end up being in plastic, and I really only need to get one good copy, I can be a little more naughty when it comes to undercuts with this stuff, because I just have to get one good copy that I can assemble a master of and send off, and then, because they're going to cut it up the way they want to cut it up anyways. Their parameters are very different than the considerations we have with traditional, you know, two-part rubber molds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's still good stuff to know, and oops, we'll help them some, so yeah.
Tom, I can't remember if I asked you this. On average, not necessarily this size, but, you know, the average 32-millimeter figure, how long did it take you to do on average?
I think I said 15. I think that's where I've tended to lay. Although in the last couple months, I think I've been getting faster on some of them. But it really can fluctuate depending on how much equipment a guy has and the kind of equipment they have. But I'd like it to be down to 10. I just need to time myself on a couple of them. To see, because frankly, I really don't entirely know. And I flip back between, like, I usually have two or three going at once. Mm-hmm. So when I get, if I'm getting, like right now, you know, I'm like noodling with this hair and stuff still, I would just set him down and I would work on something else, but I don't have anything else here, so. And I need to get him. I need to get him finished. So.
Well, but, getting into the hair. It's kind of hard to talk and really concentrate the same
time. I know. Yeah, some people can do that. I'm really bad at it. Like, I mean, I'm doing stuff, but I'm. Yeah, it's hard to. Like, I definitely would have been done with it by now if I was just doing it, but I find myself just. You know, I'm concentrating on talking, so. And I'm just moving my hand almost, so. I have gotten some stuff done, but. Yeah. It's harder to make those. You know, crucial creative decisions. But that's why I tend to always overdub my videos when I'm sculpting, because I did a couple where I recorded voice while sculpting, and it wasn't too bad, but I think they were also simpler. I was doing simpler things. So.
So the one that you're working on now, is there an armature underneath the hair?
Yeah, so this guy, he had a regular, basically human armature, except instead of the head being up here, I bent it down, and there's a big loop right here just to help have something to hold the form out. And then I had another piece of wire. It's not. It's actually very close to the body, and it's actually just for this piece. Everything else you see, it's really just... built up on large hunks of green stuff and more clay. So, but yeah, I did make a wire for that because it was sticking out there, and that I just, you know, built up with putty and then skinned with the femone, so I could do the hair the way I wanted it to be. Oops. I think we'll go for about another 7 minutes, and I think I'm going to have to shut it down. I just got... Didn't want to go too late. Oh, that's what I was going to ask you guys. Okay, so I'm working on a couple things, trying to think of other resources to make for people, things that, whether it be precast armatures, maybe another... this is 100% on top of my list, actually, is doing another some more scale reference cards for maybe a different type of thing. Immediately, dwarf comes to mind, but I mean, that could be different. But I like to do dwarves, and that's always kind of been, that was one of my first things I was doing when I was sculpting fantasy miniatures way back in the day, and so it's always been near and dear to my heart. But yeah, I don't know. So anything you guys are particularly looking for that would be helpful?
Any of those reference things would be great.
Yeah.
Are you talking like an armature template kind of thing?
Did you? Yeah, when you joined the Patreon. Well, I had it in that one video, and then anybody that joins the Patreon should be getting a link. I hope they are. Should be getting a link to it. Oh. Hey.
There's a new one.
It's my son.
Okay. I don't recall having gotten a link with that material, so
I'll get it to you. It's it is in one of the creator posts earlier on, and as well, oh. And it's on whatever video. I think I don't remember. There's a video where I have a link of it too, so it's got out there. But it's something I especially wanted to do. I want to do more of these for the patrons, you know, just to have more than just the tutorials and stuff, you know. So
yeah, those would definitely be useful. Maybe I should just dig around and not be lazy.
Well, it gets hard as it gets deep. I might put a link up on the front page for those, but it was supposed to be kind of just an extra incentive for you know, extra thank you. So that's definitely what the new ones will be. I'm not going to put them on the front page necessarily for anybody, but anybody that's a patron can certainly have them and use them. So yeah, I'm thinking about dwarves. I don't know what else people would be interested in. Fantasy races seem kind of obvious because there's so many different humanoid types. Sci-fi is, I'm sorry, there's more archetypes, I should say. With sci-fi, it's like all over the place, you know. It's either, it's this weird bug alien that's only ever used in that. But maybe that'd be cool. Maybe I should do one like that and people can try and sculpt something that I created, or basically, I don't know.
I'd like to see something on mounted figures.
Okay, yeah. I've started a horse once with the intent to put a rider on it. I think I still have the armature. Maybe I should I could bust that out and start working on it again.
There was somebody who made kind of like a mat that had all these, I think the guy was in England or somewhere, but it was like a mat, you know, like the green one you have there.
But
I think it was blue, and it had all these, just all these different scales on it of people,
sounds
animals.
Familiar.
I just saw an image of it, and I thought, well, hell, that would be useful. I wish the guy was still selling it.
The thing I've been trying to do with mine, and I know this won't work for everybody because some people want different proportions, but when I drew my own human and stuff, I wanted to purposefully design the drawing to be a little closer to the miniature proportions that I talk about as far as the heads tall, because, you know, comic books, they do 8+ heads tall, you know, for, when I say comic book, superhero stuff. But in miniature, you know, with like Games Workshop and stuff, a lot of times it's 5 heads tall, you know, or 6 at the most. They really push the proportions to really enable you to accent features like the hands and obviously the face. And, you know, it's easier to paint. That's why it's kind of a historical. I'm not entirely sure if it was just the style of the sculptor. Maybe it was easier for them to do it that way too, but it's certain. The fact is, it does make it easier to paint when you have larger proportions like that. But I tend to push mine a little closer to 7 heads tall, so which I think still looks pretty good. I'm not as big of a fan of the full true proportions though, because it does tend to make the figure look a little dainty at times. So. But I also have a stylistic proclivity towards things being a little more exaggerated like that anyways. So. It can all work.
It's understandable.
Yeah. So. Any other questions, guys?
I was wondering to the other guys here, do you guys do sculpting? You have any sculpts or stuff you're working on?
Let me see if I can find.
Andrew, yeah, he just completed one. I just finished my stands and got some stuff together. I've done some sculpting in the past, but not tiny things. more like cartoon statues, kind of a thing, like you'd see at Hallmark or something.
Oh, nice.
That kind of stuff. Not, you know.
I've got a blog you can check out from my Google Plus profile.
Oh, yeah. I'll put it in the chat.
It's mostly good. My painting, because I just started with sculpting, but you can check out what I've been doing, and I'll be posting more.
Nice. Yeah, I just started also with sculpting a few months ago.
Cool.
You got a good start too. I mean, that's a good place to start. I like the pose of that guy.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, that's probably the thing I was most happy with was that I was able to get a really dynamic pose. Even though the detail and stuff wasn't as good as I'd like, but you know, that'll come later, just practice.
Mm-hmm. Sure. That is a really challenging thing to do, is a good pose to get the life into such a small little thing, make it look real and not just a statue or something. It adds a lot, in my opinion. and makes the details sometimes not even matter as much because got a lot of excitement and stuff going on. Oops.
I just put my website for my other stuff. There's no sculpting stuff. Like I said, I'm new to sculpting, but my other work.
You guys know how to see the chat?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's got the left over there.
Right.
Cool alien.
Rich did the 3D models for Medieval Games. I almost call it Medieval Times. It's one of my favorite Wii games. It's like Mario Party, but medieval style. I'm trapped. There we go.
Oh, yeah. Cool 3D stuff, too. Yeah, I like it.
Thanks.
Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, the alien, I just got, I recently got that flying frog conquest of planet Earth, so aliens have been in my head a lot. That's kind of fitting.
Hey, Tom, I found the link to the armature reference.
Okay.
Is it okay for me to post it?
Yeah.
All right.
Alrighty. I should make this smaller so I can actually see the rest of my screen. There we go.
Is this Tom's?
Yeah, that's from Tom. That's what I he gave up.
Oh, that link. I thought you meant the other one. Well, yeah, absolutely put it up.
Which other link?
I thought you were talking about that animal proportion thing we were talking about earlier.
No. Yeah, if I find a picture of that thing, I'll send a link or something just so you probably know what I'm talking about. I imagine you've seen it.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I've seen it before.
Andrew, what are you using to sculpt with?
Used a wire armature with Nidotite, and I detailed it up with Super Sculpey.
Ah, cool.
Have you found a favorite tool yet?
I like those
or
colored
main tool. Yeah.
I got a bunch of them at an art supply store before I started.
Yeah, they're very handy. I still prefer like a nice metal burnisher the most, but I use the color shaper, clay shapers all the time.
Yeah, I've also got a nice set of micro tools that I got from Duluth Trading Company.
Mm-hmm.
Like dental picks and tweezers and
cool.
You know, stuff, needles, stuff like that. And that's come in pretty useful.
Did you order those online?
I think I did. The toolkit might have been from a catalog, but I know they're online too. I actually ordered it for work, but I paid for it myself, so I for my hobby purposes. But. Yeah, and the color shapers, I just got at an art supply shop.
Yeah, I love those things.
Yeah.
Those are hard to find in physical stores, but they are around.
Yeah, everything I've had to order online. I can't find any of that stuff locally.
Whoa. All right, well, any other closing comments or thoughts or anything you guys want to talk about real quick before we end for tonight?
Nope, I think I, at least for now.
Yeah, we'll think something.
All right, guys. Well, thanks for being here. It was fun. I'm really excited that it actually worked, that we got three of you on here and stuff. So I think I have figured out the secret. It is that we have to send like individual invites after the thing is up. So we'll know that for future. And hope to see you guys next month.
All right.
Take care, everybody.
Yeah.
See you later, guys.